sir. All right. Okay, I think we're ready. Amen. Brother Rob, if you want to come up, amen. Thank you again for stopping in with us. What's the time difference for you?
It's almost exactly 12 hours. It's 11 hours, 45 minutes.
So you, how long have you been out of Nepal now?
It's been about a week and a half now.
So you're still with dealing with
that?
They
say it's about a day per hour of time difference that it takes to recover.
Wow.
So we're still inside that window.
So you're on day 7 of 12. So I like that. Again. Well, thank you for being with us. I really appreciate it. Amen. Is this on? Make sure. Turn this up. Check. Amen. There we go. Amen. Tell us a little bit about your brother, how you're doing and everything, and then I'll get the video.
All right. Thank you. My name is Rob Roberts, my wife Grace, my sons Timothy and Caleb. Timothy was born about 5 months before we left for the mission field, and Caleb was born on the mission field. I guess he can say like the preacher, you know, he was born in the work of the Lord, at least, you know, born into it. We have lots of stories about trying to get his passport afterward. It took about a year to get the birth certificate and passport and everything, you know, arranged for him. But it is a precious thing to be able to tell people, you know, that my son was born in Nepal. It really helps us to be able to relate to people. Before the video, I just wanted to tell a short word about Nepal. First of all, this video, my wife said I had to remind you all, is ages, is that what you said, ages old? It was made actually at the end of 2015. We made it for several of our churches and we haven't made a new one since, but it does have some good video and pictures of the work of the Lord there. But first, I want to tell you a little bit about Nepal. Nepal is a Hindu country. And most people there are very fiercely proud of their customs, their traditions, their heritage, and frankly, their false religion. And the devil uses that to keep people enslaved in that false religion. Over 81% of the people in Nepal actively practice Hinduism. Children are still sold into sex slavery at temples around the country. Bloody goat and chicken sacrifices are made daily to the goddess, you know, Kali and others, actually just almost within sight of our house, just on the other side of the valley where we live. Idols and temples to false gods are on every street corner. And when I say every, I mean there's one in front of my house. I mean out the window of my office in our home, I look down and I see people chanting and ringing bells. And, you know, there's one about, you know, 100 yards or less down to the left. And, you know, on the major intersections, there are Hindu temples and idols everywhere. Human sacrifice is still practiced on an annual basis in certain villages right in our area, about a half kilometer from where we live. Along the rivers, bodies are burned and they brush their ashes into the holy river, and they have the altars in the area set up about every half kilometer through the city area and kilometer after that. And every morning, we wake up to clanging bells, blowing horns, people chanting and offering up their acts of devotion. You know, there are certain things that we see our neighbors doing every day to false idols, to stone idols, wooden idols, and all of that. When you read about Kathmandu, most people have heard of Kathmandu at least somewhere, you'll read about pollution. You know, it ranks always in the bottom five of the cities around the entire world. They say that living there is the equivalent of smoking 11 cigarettes a day, just the pollution in the air. It's always on the bottom there. You'll read about the lack of infrastructure, the literacy problems. Maybe you'll see about the earthquakes from 2015. But saddest of all is the fact that in the name of developing, it seems like the people there have developed or have taken all of the worst aspects of Western culture. You know, you name it when it comes to, you know, the LGBT, pornography, death metal music, lascivious dress styles, divorce, feminism, abortion, you know, you name it. It seems like they adopt all of the worst of these while still trying to, you know, work that into their Hinduism. In fact, I read when I was studying for coming here and trying to find out, you know, what I want to tell people about Nepal, I found out that the abortion rate in Nepal is double that of the United States and increasing at a rate double that of the United States also. It really is crazy. When you put it, it's like they jumped off the deep end into some of these things that, you know, America, you know, we know that it's getting worse and worse as these days continue, but, you know, it's moving slower than that at least. But this is the place where the Lord has called us to labor, you know, not for beauty, not for adventure, but for souls, for reaching people. And the Lord's given us a number of different ministry opportunities there in Nepal. You'll see some stuff about the earthquake relief. We've been able to work with a local Baptist Bible college. We have a children's feeding program that runs 5 days a week. And we have, you know, 75 to 85 children that come every single night and hear God's word taught taught and preached throughout the week. We have a gospel radio program there in Nuwari, which is a language that not many people are trying to work in. This is the first of its kind. But our primary focus is the church, Biswas Bible Baptist Church, and the same sort of work that you all do, just in a different culture and in a different way. Soul winning, discipleship, working with people, growing them, and trying to get them close to the Lord. Let's go ahead and watch the video and watch that.
Nepal, one of the least developed countries in the world. It's located between India and China in Southeast Asia. More than 28 million people call Nepal home, and that population is spread out across its diverse landscape, jungles, flatlands, hills, and its famous towering mountains.
But behind its natural beauty, Satan has long held Nepal in a chokehold. Less than 1.5% of the population claims to be Christian. The vast majority of the Nepalese are practicing Hindus, and their constitution expressly prohibits conversions from one religion to another. Mission work in Nepal must be carefully undertaken with a balance of boldness and caution. Those caught proselytizing are swiftly ejected. Stone and wooden idols and temples are found on nearly every corner, and each morning finds worshippers ringing their prayer bells, chanting prayers, and making offerings to false gods. It is in this darkness that the light of the gospel shines brightest, and while the government tries to keep Christ out of Nepal, hearts all across the country are searching for the truth. In January of 2011, Rob, Grace, and five-month-old Timothy arrived in Nepal excited about sharing the truth of the gospel. They quickly found a place to live, enrolled in language school, and jumped right into the ministry work at Hope Baptist Church in Kathmandu.
Right away, we were able to teach and preach in Bible college, help out in the song service, and bring people to church to tell them about Christ.
Later that year, they moved to Mayima Baptist Church, a Nepali church on the south side of the valley in Naku, where Rob preaches and the family helps with other ministries.
For my birthday in 2012, Grace got me a mountain bike. I started riding all the trails that crisscross the countryside and connect the villages, all the little walking trails, and it opened up Nepal to me in a way that I hadn't ever seen before.
A short trail ride could reach remote villages full of people who had never heard the gospel or seen a foreigner. Rob wrote a simple Nepali gospel tract to pass out along with candy to people he met along the way. While riding in an out-of-the-way nearby valley full of rice fields and goat herds, he came across a small village called Sinokokona.
As I rode through this village time after time, God gave me a special word for that area and the people there that had never heard the gospel. About one time I stopped and talked to an old goat herd, and I asked him, "Do you know about Jesus?" But he had never heard any of Jesus, not even one time. And he pointed up at his old tongue and the herd next to him and said, "That's the only God that I know and worship."
Another day, Rob stopped in a tiny cattle shelter for some shade and rest. When he sat down, a resting shepherd approached and started asking for music.
I was sure I misunderstood him, but he kept asking for a song for his hand, which I instantly pulled out and twisted and palsied up hand. And he told me that when he heard Bible songs, when he sang Bible songs, it helped his hand feel a little bit better. And soon he also pulled out of his pocket a tattered old section that was torn out of a Nepali hymnbook. And there on the side of the trail, we sang songs in English, in Nepali, and people gathered around to hear those Bible songs sung.
Rob came back later to follow up and started teaching him the Bible each week. Because of his crippled hand, the shepherd's family treated him like an outcast. Rob and Gamendra would meet and study the Bible in the fields and, on rainy days, in cattle shelters.
Occasionally others would join us, but most of the time it was just he and I and his goats. They're worshiping, praising the Lord, studying the Bible.
Finally, in January of 2014, they rented a traditional Nuwari mud and brick building alongside a narrow dirt trail on the edge of the village. It was being used to house buffalo and store drying corn. They cleaned it up and started meeting there each week to study the Bible and worship. They soon started a Tuesday night children's Bible club in the same building. Where adults were cautious and wary, the children were open and accepting. The Lord blessed, and they quickly had a group of 15 kids coming each week to memorize verses and learn Bible stories.
Through those churches, we've been able to reach out to the community. They see our love for the children. They see us spending time with them. And because of that, they open up. We've
had Christmas services that were completely packed out, where the gospel is being preached to almost every single adult and the entire village. Please pray for the people in the Copeland Valley. On April 25th, in the morning church service, the preacher was wrapping up his message. Suddenly, the church building began to move. At first, it was just shaking and vibrations, but it quickly started swaying and swinging until I could barely even keep my balance, and we're already sitting on the floor. We all gathered around the support beams to try and stay, you know, in the safest place possible, but I sincerely thought that the entire building was going to cave in. It was going to fall out from underneath us any second. And it was truly a miracle that God protected us in that earthquake. When they went down to check out the Coconut Church building, they walked through the destroyed village and had to scramble over piles of rubble from collapsed buildings. As they came down the small path, the church building was standing with no damage whatsoever. It was constructed no differently than every other building that was destroyed that day, but the Lord protected it.
Right away, we were able to house people in the church building who had lost their homes and, in many cases, everything they owned, including their entire worth of stored food.
The earthquake provided an amazing opportunity to not only preach the love of Christ, but show it in actions and deeds.
From the beginning, we had no idea how this would change our work and our lives here in Nepal. No, our house hadn't fallen down. But we were instantly surrounded by people that had lost everything and were going through the hardest times that they would ever see in their entire lives.
The next day, they were out looking for ways to help. It started simply with bringing hot tea and snacks to serve the workers that were pulling rubble. But the next few months saw them traveling to remote villages to survey damage, clearing rubble, traveling with and helping medical relief teams, building temporary and permanent shelters for those who had lost their homes, delivering food and medical supplies, installing water filtration systems, teaching, preaching, counseling, and comforting the brokenhearted, all the while sharing the love of Christ and the gospel message with people who might never have heard without the earthquake. Those who went through what is now referred to as the Great Gorkha Earthquake will never forget where they were when the earth shook. The earthquake has had a dramatic effect on their lives.
Every time we get another strong aftershock, we literally hear a collective roar come up from the community around us as terrified people are just afraid of the earthquake and what might be coming again.
The earthquake wreaked havoc in a country whose people already lived a difficult life. It reached into every aspect of life and will continue to affect people for many years to come.
Many people lost their family members, their ancestral homes were completely destroyed. The trauma and those tragic memories, they're going to live with those forever.
In the wake of the earthquake, the Lord opened the door to start a children's feeding ministry where the Bible is taught each week. Now they are in the process of replicating that ministry in the village of Dukuchap in conjunction with a new church plant.
After so much problem with the relief work, God has given me a special burden for the training of the remote village pastors. So many of these men are just baby Christians themselves. And while they have the great spirit and the great attitude, they really need that training and encouragement so that they don't fall prey to false doctrine themselves.
I will tell them everything so far away.
please pray for the Robidoux family as they minister to the people of Nepal and for the Nepalese as they recover and rebuild from the earthquake.
Amen. All right, turn the light, turn those lights on back for me. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, amen. How many ready to go to Nepal with me? Amen. Here we go. And well, every time I see a missions video, I surrender to the Lord. And so I'm here. Amen. Thank you, Brother Rob, for coming. Amen. Keep them in prayer. Do you have prayer cards with you by chance? Okay, amen. Make sure you grab a prayer card from them. I don't know. If you're like me, you get a prayer card, amen, add it to your list, amen, your collection, and pray over those missionaries and keep them in prayer. How many of you are familiar with that earthquake that happened? How many of you are familiar with that? I had not heard about that until I watched your video, amen. And so now you meet somebody who's affected by that and what they're doing for the Lord, amen. What a blessing. And make sure you shake their hand, tell them that you're glad that they came with us tonight. Boy, what a blessing. All right, we got to get right in. Amen. I got to hurry. And we're going to get right into our Bible study tonight. Amen. Go in your Bible here back to, we're going to go back over a little bit, kind of do a little bit of a recap. We're going to kind of cover some ground we covered last week and then finish where we start, or finish what we started. Go to back to Psalms 119, verse number 6. Psalms 119, verse number 6. Amen. Amen. We started talking about last week respect, amen, in church ethics, and we've been going over this series of things for the last couple weeks and want to be a help to you, mainly inside the local church, amen. Now, the Word of God covers every area of life, amen, but I wanted to kind of help you with things inside the local church and kind of understanding how we do things and how God gives things to us to do. We talked about how to handle problems inside the local church. We've talked about, we're going to go over about gossip inside the local church. That's a good one, amen, and make sure you go tell everybody that we're going to talk about gossip and you'll pick that up later. Amen. We're going to go over a lot of different things that I just kind of want to just to help you with and get you a bearing with, get you an understanding from the Word of God. This area of respect, I think, is necessary. And again, respect can go to every area of life, but I want to help you with just the topic inside the house of God. Last week, we talked about two areas of respect. Number one, we talked about in the area of authority. Amen. And respecting the authority at the house of God. Just as God has set up authority in the home, and God has set up authority in the government, so God has set up authority in the church. Amen? Three institutions that God has established. Amen? The home, the government, and the local church. In every institution, God establishes authority for those institutions. Amen? So we talked about respecting authority, talking about through the pastor, the deacons, the Sunday school teachers, anybody in that position of authority, just having that respect for. And remember, we talked about respect. The word respect means to view. It means to regard. It's how you view something. Respect is all about viewing it the right way. Amen? Viewing something with a high regard, to consider with a degree of reverence. Amen? And so teaching our young people for the next generation how to view the authority is very important to the respect for that they will give. Amen? And teaching them that, and we talked about that, especially in the home. Amen? Mom and dad, you have the responsibility to teach your young people to respect your spouse. Mom teaches the young people to respect dad. Dad teaches the young people to respect mom and teach them to have a view of high regard or reverence for that authority. If we're not careful, that we can get into a rut in our homes where our children have no respect for their mom or dad simply because we're not encouraging how they view mom or dad. Amen. And how that's why it's so important to be careful with what kids watch on TV. TV is trying to teach your children to view mom and dad as complete goofballs. You watch teen shows, even to the children now. You watch mom and dad are slobs. Mom and dad are just considered abnormal, fuddy-duddy, the weird ones. And the kids are the ones with all the ideas. They're the ones that are always right. And mom and dad are always apologizing to the kids. And that's not how God set it up. God set it up as mom and dad to teach the next generation about life, not the kids to teach mom and dad about life. And they've got done it the opposite, amen? And so important. So teaching your young people to view with a high regard in your home, but especially in the place of church, amen? If you've got to teach your young people how to view the authority at church. And one way to do this, and we talked about it, and I just go over it real fast, one way to do it is how they address the authority. Teaching our young people to address authority in a different manner than they do everybody else will help that level of respect. Amen? We try to teach Adeline, amen, when she comes up, and as much as we can, she's we're amen to you. And she'll be three, amen, coming up. I can't believe it. And I got to tell you a quick story, amen, just by the way. Amen. We were, I was videoing Adeline, and Adeline goes soul winning with me, you know, and so I was videoing her, and she was inviting me to Amazing Grace Baptist Church. And I said, well, thank you. And she's giving me one of our gospel tracks. And she goes, I invite you, Amazing Grace Baptist. And she doesn't say Baptist, it's Baptist Church. And I said, well, thank you. And I said, where is it? She goes, oh, it's on Harry and Webb. And I went, wow. I said, well, how do I get there? She goes, get off of Kellogg. And I went, wow, amen. Could not believe it, amen. And so kids listen, amen. And so important, your children listen to you. Children are copycats. They will watch mom and dad. They will watch the people in their life, and they will learn how to view others based on the influence that they have. And so mom and dad, so important to help children have a respect for others, especially adults and authority inside the local church, is all dependent on how you treat the authority and how you teach them to treat the authority. Teaching them to say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, no, sir, no, ma'am. Teaching them to say, and not call authority by first name. Amen on that one. There was a day in our country where children did not walk up and say, hey, Richard. Amen. Hey, Paul. Now, there's one thing for us as adults, amen, but not for kids. Why? Because you want to teach them to have a level of respect, amen. The adults are not their buddy buddies. Now, I want to be a friend for our children. But I don't want my child to learn to walk up and say, hello. I have a hard time saying it because I've known Miss Dotson since I was a child, amen. And hello, Tamara. Okay, I didn't get slapped. Phew. I'm waiting for my mom to call me, son. Don't. I'm telling you, my mom, if she ever would have heard us call an adult by their first name, boy, you talk about, we'd have been in big trouble, amen. And I'd have been sore. And why? Because mom taught us to have a respect. How do we do that? By how we treat other people and teaching us how to view adults. I mean, so important, amen. So viewing the authority. Number two, we talked about viewing the Word of God, or having a respect for the Word of God. Look there, Psalms 119, verse 6. Let's hurry. Then shall I not be ashamed when I have respect unto all thy commandments. One reason that we have a hard time with this generation, amen, not talking about necessarily inside the local church, but in the world in general, and it's bleeding into our local churches, we have a hard time getting them to follow and obey the Word of God. Why? They have no respect for it. Why do our children have no respect for the Word of God? We talked about it. Because we as God's people have not taught them, number one, the authority of God's Word. Number two, we don't live it ourselves. And so because we don't practice the Bible, and we never read our Bible, and we never carry our Bible, our children have no respect for the Bible because they don't see it. And so important, if we want to help our young people to have a respect for the Word of God, then it's got to be treated with the utmost respect. It's got to be shown with high regard. It's got to be practiced with high regard. Amen. It's got to be looked at as saying, as we believe the Bible, we practice. Adeline, this last week, it was funny. She was asking Mom a question, Sarah and I a question about something, and we told her it's because that's what Jesus said to do. It's what the Bible says. And what are we trying to do? We're trying to help her understand that she needs to have a respect for the Word of God above all else. And the reason we do things is because that's what Jesus said to do. Can you go in your life and look at the things in your life and look at what you do and put it to the Bible test? If you can't say because the Bible says to do it, then one day when those young people ask, why do we do that? Adeline's in that why stage. I haven't gone through this yet. Amen. All the parents, I need help. And she's going, why daddy this? Why daddy? She looked at me. She said, Dad, why do you wear shoes? I said, so my feet don't hurt, amen? And because she walks around without shoes. She's crazy, amen? I said, you little hillbilly. No, we wear shoes around here, amen? And we're born in Kansas, and we're not from, hillbilly country, redneck, where my wife's from, South Texas, amen? And Yeah, that's what she did too. Oh, and so we have fun. So respect for the Word of God. Amen. Now, next, we're going to go over real fast a couple other things I want to help you with tonight. But look there again, Psalms 119. One more verse. Let's go. Let's look there, verse number. Psalms 119, let me find it. Here we go. Verse number 14. I have rejoiced in the way of thy testimonies as much as in all riches. I will meditate in thy precepts and have respect unto thy ways. Amen. Have a respect unto thy ways. There's a lot of ways that people can go. There's a lot of ways that you can decide to go. But if we will stick with the Word of God, meditate in those things, then our children will have a respect for God's ways because they'll see what God does for us. See, if they'll see what, hey, God took care of mom and dad, and when they tithed, then they'll have a respect for God saying, God can take care of me. They have a level, they view God in high regard because they see the blessings that God has given to us as we walk the way of the Word of God. And so they'll say, hey, that way is true, that way is tried, and that way is tested. Amen. 3-point outline. I'm going to preach that next Sunday. Amen. Next, number three, we got to have a respect, amen, and then we're talking about inside the local church, have a respect, and this is very simple, for belongings. Let me just help you a little bit tonight. Amen. Just very simple. Have a respect for belongings. Amen. Two things in this life that either they belong to others or it belongs to the Lord. Amen. Teaching our children, helping them to understand, and I'm going to get somewhere with this, but in our churches, we've got to help our young people, we've got to help the next generation, and we've got to help the world around us as they come into the local church, teaching them to have a respect for belongings, amen? And we have a big problem in America with theft, and we don't have a problem inside the church, thank the Lord, amen? But this generation, they have no problem with taking what does not belong to them. You look on the news all the time. There's no respect for the things of others. There's even not a respect anymore. Vandalism is crazy. I mean, and just all of those things. And these are simple things that we think, well, what's the big deal? Let me tell you, if we're not careful, we don't teach our children to have a respect for the belongings of others, then those on the outside, amen, the influence of friends, they're going to teach them, and we're going to be in big trouble. Amen. And you're going to see that influence. Teaching them, amen, especially inside the house of God, amen, teaching them that things that belong to other people are not theirs. Amen. My dad used to tell me, if it's not yours, keep your grubby hands off of it. Amen. And I used to get in big trouble because, you know, I liked stuff. And if I wasn't careful, I'd be a hoarder, amen, and take things. And so having respect for everybody in the church, but also this area of having a respect for what belongs to the Lord. Amen. Having a respect for what belongs to God. Amen. I believe that we've got to make sure, and again, I think this is something that we do, but I want to, well, we've got to make sure we teach our young people, helping them to have a respect for things that belong to the Lord. Amen. We don't treat God's house as our house. Amen. We don't treat God's house as our house, teaching them that these things belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, not to us. Amen. And so important, amen, even as adults, that as we remind ourselves that we're careful to help set an example for the next generation, for those that come inside, that yes, we enjoy church. Yes, boy, we have a good time, and I love coming to church and having fun and doing things, but we also make sure that we have a respect for what it is and saying, again, it belongs to the Lord. Amen. And keeping that respect. Why? Because if we teach them that church is set apart, and we teach our young people by our example and how they live that these things belong to the Lord, we don't treat them like we do everything else, that will help them have a respect for God and say, okay, that's more important. That's important because of who it belongs to. Amen. And let me help you. Teaching your young people have a respect for the Lord. Teach them when they treat the house of God to treat it as God's house. Amen. Boy, Dad used to teach me, and I know that it helped me. If it can be taught to me, it can be taught to anybody. Amen. And Dad used to teach me when we came to church that, son, these things are the Lord's. We don't mess with this. We don't do this. We don't play around with this. We don't do this. We don't go here. Why? Because he said, this is God's. And God is watching. Amen. We used to learn a song in Sunday school. I so appreciate Sunday school. Amen. And, be careful, little hands, what you do. Careful, little hands, what you do. For the Father up above, he is looking down in love. Careful, little hands, what you do. And so, you know, we'd go and we'd do something, play around as kids. And my mom would come by and say, be careful, little hands, what you do. And she'd give us that look and say, we'd say, the father's looking in love, and mom is saying, hey, that's right, but I'm going to beat your bottom. And yes, ma'am. And well, I'm teaching them to have a respect for the things of God. So important, amen. Hey, another thing about it, just even in life, amen, teaching our young people respect is how to treat things and how to put it back the way it was found. Boy, in this generation, trash and littering is everywhere. You go downtown, amen, now during the Riverfest and all this stuff, all you see is just a bunch of junk, a bunch of trash, and people just throwing stuff on the side of the road. Why? They're not taught a respect. Amen. We're not taught to clean up after themselves. They're not taught, put things back the way you found it. If it was clean when you got there, clean it up when you leave. Amen. And how much more should it be inside the house of God? Amen. How much more? Help them learn that here, and what will happen is they'll carry what they learn here into their everyday life. They'll learn that here just with the simple things, and they'll walk into life one day, and you'll turn around, and they'll clean up after themselves. All of a sudden, you say, where'd you learn that from? Well, we do it at church. Most of my life lessons were taught at church, amen. When I went to interview for my first job, it was funny, the lady said, she was asking me questions, amen, and it was my first interview, you know, it was my first interview, and the lady was asking me questions, and I just told her how I would respond. She goes, wow. She's like, where'd you learn that? I said, church. She's like, how do you handle this person? And I told her, I said, well, you know, this is how we do this, and what would you do in this situation? I said, well, I would do this here. And she goes, you know, how would you handle if somebody was, you know, unhappy, disgruntled, and, you know, I said, well, this is what I would do. She goes, you sound like you've handled it before. I said, yes, ma'am, I used to have a bus route. People are not always happy coming to church on the bus, amen, especially when you pick up them kids at 6 o'clock in the morning, amen. You handle a lot of disgruntled people. And so, understand, you'll teach them those things here, and I promise you, they'll carry those things into their everyday life. But so important to start inside the house of God. So let's teach our young people to have a respect for the things of the Lord. If it belongs to God, teach them that it's something different. It's not something that we treat as if it was our own. Amen. It's something that we view with a higher regard. Amen. We view it with a higher respect. Amen. But why? Because it belongs to the Lord. And so important even with something else. It belongs to someone else. Amen. We respect that more because that does not belong to us. We treat that with a little more reverence because that is someone else's. Amen. Well, we were talking with a guy, the insurance came and was looking at the bus with the hail damage, and the guy talked about, you know, he's had to look at cars that have been keyed, you know, and people just coming and just scraping cars. You know, he said, you wouldn't believe what happened. Somebody did not teach their young person respect for the things of others. Well, there used to be a generation where respect was highly valued. Amen. Now it's the opposite. Now we have a generation to where it's the cool thing to go and vandalize. It's the cool thing to go out and destroy other people's property. It's the cool thing for our... And so we're busy trying to teach our young people this and this and this, and then we have to fight a generation that has a lack of respect. And you and mom and dads, amen, you're fighting for those young people. Help them here, amen. Keep them in the safety and the haven of the house of God. And we as adults, as we live that and we practice that, we help every mom and dad inside the church by showing them that and help and living that, and our young people carry that in the rest of their daily lives. Amen. Number four. What else we ought to have respect for? Ready? Number four, respect for the opposite gender. Listen to me, as a pastor, I worry and I pray for this generation. When you see, amen, Wichita, Kansas, have you seen in the schools how many problems there are between the teachers and students? Have you seen how many people arrested for the assaults? How many know what I'm talking about? How many have seen that? Look on the news. Have you seen the problems with a misconduct between teachers? We're not talking about between students. We're talking about between teachers and students in our public schools. How many would ever have thought, the older generation, how many have ever thought you'd see the day that would happen? Never. What's happened? We have lowered down a barrier of respect between the genders. And listen, we've got to keep that at high regard inside the church. Why? Because you see what happens in the world when respect for the opposite gender is lowered. Look at the problems they have. And so if we're not careful and we don't keep that in high regard at the church, those same problems will bleed right in here. So what are we talking about, Pastor? Teaching our young men and our... let's start with our young men. Teaching them to have a respect, an old-fashioned respect for ladies. Hey, it was once taught when a lady's coming that you hold the door open. Amen. It was once taught where when a lady has nowhere to sit, that a man offers her offers his seat. What was that? It was teaching the young men a respect for ladies. It was teaching them to view a lady as somebody different. Amen. It's one thing to go around and pal around and wrestle with the guys. Amen. Boy, we used to go to camp and do mud wrestling. How many have ever mud wrestled? Anybody ever done that? Oh, let me tell you, that is the bomb diggity right there. Amen. They would dig a hole. If you've never done it, we got to do it at the church. We got a 40, we got a, you know, a back 40 over here. And they would dig this hole, you know, about 3 foot deep all the way around, probably, you know, in a big circle. And then they just take water and dump water into it for like 2 days. I mean, make that thing where you got in it and it was up to your knees in mud. And so then they take the guys in there and you take in, they said, bring clothes, you throw away. Amen. Bring clothes, you throw away. So we did. We got in there and they would have, you know, they'd pair us up and then we would go slopping in there. You know, and they'd say, go. And the first one to get the guy and throw him in the mud, you know, and get him on his back and hold him down. And, you know, you're like covered in mud. You're just like, ah, you know. And so we were laughing. I'll tell you a story and I got to move on. We were laughing at one guy. There was this real big guy. He was probably, I don't remember, he was 6 foot. Three, you know, of course, to me back then, anybody taller than me was like 6 foot something. You know, I was 4 foot nine. You know, but he was huge. I mean, he had to be 6 foot tall, big old guy. And he got matched up with this little skinny stick. Yeah, I mean, this guy, you could look at him, and if he turned sideways, he'd disappear. I mean, he was just so skinny. You know, if he turned sideways, stick his tongue out, he'd look like a zipper. You know, I mean, he was so skinny. And so we were laughing. We were like, oh, this is going to be great, amen. And so they're like, all right, on your marks, get set, go. And so the little skinny guys got him. And that big guy, all he did was turn him around, grab him, and fall. We just all started laughing. And all you see is his arms. And they're like, all right, amen. It's one thing to do that with guys. Boy, we have a lot of fun. But teaching our young people, our young men, that ladies are different. Teaching them to have a respect for the opposite gender where they don't treat the opposite gender as another man. And this generation is doing this where they're taking away that level of respect where now guys and girls are just buddy-buddy to the point we're teachers and students. Why? Because listen to me, this is the mindset now of the students. Well, whether they're 16 or 25, what's it matter? Because there's no respect. Well, what's it matter if she's 30 or 18? There's no respect. But when you teach them to have a respect, and you teach them that you keep your hands off a lady, if she's not your mom or your sister, you keep your hands off of her. And then you teach them that that's not normal, so what happens is when somebody comes and does try to touch them, they say, no, we don't do that. Because you, mark it down, mom and dad, somebody is going to approach your young person one of these days. And somebody with ill intentions will approach your young person one of these days, and if they know the proper respect is we don't pile around, then you're going to save them from a lot of heartache. But we have so many problems to the point where in our public schools we have nurseries. Why? Because somebody broke down the barrier of respect. Somebody has forgot to teach those young men that those young ladies are somebody's future wife one day. And unless God has ordained, and unless you have approval, then keep your hands off of them. And we've lost that respect in this generation. And this is why, listen to me, this is why when you look on the Wichita News, just in this city alone, we deal with so many misconduct and inappropriate problems. Because we are losing a respect for the opposite gender. We're not teaching our children. How many times have I seen where my wife is going into a store and teenagers just, they don't even open the door or offer. And boy, it boils my blood. I don't know if you're like me, but I just want to wring somebody's neck. You know, like you do those old, you know, those chickens. That's what I want to do, wring somebody's neck. Why? Because that's a lady. And I want my wife to be treated with respect. Because I treat everybody else's wife with respect. Amen. And boy, let's teach our young people, teach them how to have that respect for the opposite gender. Start at the home. Teach them to have that respect even just with mom and sister. Teach them to have that respect for their mother. Teach them that, you know, it was once taught, if you see a lady carrying a heavy load, you offer to help. Amen. That was once, that was common thought. Amen. Somebody, if a lady's struggling, you offer to help as a man. Amen. Dad taught me that. He said, if you see your mom having problems and struggling, you drop anything you're doing. I don't care if you're playing in the middle of a football game. You drop whatever you're doing and you go help your mother. And that's what we was taught. And we need that once again in this country. We need that, where young men stop whatever they're doing to have a respect for. It was once taught in America when a lady walked into the room, all the men stood. It was once taught when a lady came into a man's presence, they took their hat off. Why? It was all about teaching respect for the opposite gender. And that's why marriages used to last 60 and 65 years. Now they don't pass 10. Why? Because somebody has lost teaching that respect. And so important. Let's not lose that at the house of God. Let's have a respect for each other. Let's have a respect as adults for each other and teach our young people how to have that level of respect. I was working, I'll give you this illustration, be done. I was working at a hospital, and a lady that was, I'm trying to remember, she'd been working there probably 50 years, and she'd been working there a long time. And she would let me call her grandma sometimes, because she was old enough to be grandma. And she'd tell me, she'd say, "Rich, I sure do love you." Amen. And so she would came up one time, and she gave me a hug. And I was taught that when you give a lady a hug, you do it with one arm on this side. And she said, "That's not taught anymore." She said, "I have a lot of respect for you, young man." She said, "Because anymore, it's not been taught that way." And she said, "You keep up what you're doing." It's all about teaching respect. It's all about helping and understanding and keeping that barrier. Amen. Teaching that. Amen. We try to have a rule for Adlin, teacher. You know, you stay 6 inches from the boys. Why? Because I want her to learn a respect, and I want her to learn that there's a barrier. As much as possible. Why? So that way when she gets older, she learns it's not normal if a young man comes up and puts his arm around her. Amen. You adults know what I'm talking about. You know, a young man come up, try to sneak his arm around her. He does that, and boy, he'll be looking right down my barrel. I bought a 12-gauge shotgun just for that reason. You stick your arm around my daughter, and you'll be looking at Bessie. He's got your name carved right on it. In fact, I'll saw the barrel off right there while I'm doing it. Hit you with the barrel, then blow the gun. Amen. No, and so important. Amen. And then last thing, and we'll get out of here. And teaching a respect here, and I want you to see this. This is very important. This is where we're going to get into most of our Bible real fast. Don't have a respect of persons. Look at Proverbs 24, verse 23. There's lots of verses we could get into, and we're not going to. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 23. This is important inside the house of God. Proverbs 24, 23. Look at the Bible says, "These things also belong to the wise. It is not good to have respect of persons in judgment." Hold your finger there, James chapter 2. James chapter 2. God echoes this in the New Testament. James chapter 2. "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. For if there come into your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, Sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, Stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts?" Amen. So important inside the house of God to not have a respect of persons. Teaching our young people that everybody is the same. Just because somebody has more money than someone else does not make them inferior to everybody else. Treating young people that everybody is the same. Why? Because if we'll teach our young people to not have a respect of persons, listen, they'll take the gospel to anybody. Well, you know why sometimes the gospel doesn't go to the third countries, to the third world countries of the world? Because nobody wants to go and get dirty. Why? Because we don't look at everybody the same. We look at that as inferior, and we're not going to go there. We're gonna stay here where it's comfortable. And so we've taught, and we're not careful. We teach our young people that this is different. Everybody's the same. Now, yes, we ought to teach them to be clean. Yes, we ought to teach them to live in a godly manner. But teaching them that no matter who they meet, everybody deserves an opportunity to hear the gospel. Everybody, the Bible says here that if they come in and you offer a seat to the rich, but you don't offer a seat to the poor, God looks at that as wrong. God says it is not good to have respect of persons in judgment. It doesn't matter who walks in the door, they deserve the front seat just as much as if the president were here. Nobody is deserving, amen, of something more than anybody else. Treat everybody the same. Number two, expect the same of everyone. No one is allowed to break the rules. Listen to me, let me help you. Resentment is a result of favoritism. Resentment in the lives of people is a result of favoritism. When we teach our young people that everybody does not have to follow the same set of rules, then you get resentment. Remember what happened to Jacob and his 12 sons? He had more favoritism towards Joseph, and he gave him a coat of many colors and not the rest of them, and there was a lot of resentment. Why? Because he treated somebody different and did not expect the same of all his young people. And so if we're not careful and we don't expect the same of everyone, then we're going to cause division inside the house of God, where these people have to abide by these rules, but these people don't. Well, I don't have to do it that way, but everybody else does. So important, amen. Even as the pastor, God says expect the same of everybody. The pastor should be held to the same standard as everybody else. Just because I'm a pastor doesn't give me the right to break the rules. I get to make the rule. No, I'm just kidding. And the Word of God is the rule book, and nobody gets to break or make those rules except God Himself. Amen. So teach them, amen, to expect the same of everyone. And then number three, last, do not judge one and not the other. And there was more verses again. Proverbs 28:21, Psalms 138:6. All of these echo the same thing, and that's that God says it is not good to have a respect of persons, and especially in the area of judgment. This is so important, and I'll be done. And I'll close my notes. Inside the house of God, amen, there are things that we do and rules that we follow. And so important that when it comes to judgment or when it comes to taking care of issues, we have to have a respect in the sense of where nobody, we will judge this person just as much as we will judge the other. Nobody's allowed to get away with breaking those rules. Nobody's allowed to get away. If we're not careful, what happens in church is we'll sweep something under the rug because of who did it, but we'll be fast to expose it because of this person that did it. And God says it doesn't matter, and especially inside the house of God, it doesn't matter what happens. Let's say, God forbid, there was ever a question of conduct inside the local church. Well, God says it doesn't matter who does it. You don't sweep it under the rug. You get it and taken care of. It doesn't matter if it's the leadership, and it doesn't matter if it's nobody. You take care of that, and you don't have a respect of persons. You judge this person just as much as you would judge this person, and you make sure that it's followed to the T according to the Word of God. Because God has no respect of persons, and God says, I will judge. David thought he could get away with the rules. David thought he could break it and commit adultery with Bathsheba. And God brought Nathan the prophet along that said, thou art the man. And so important that even we understand that even at the house of God, it doesn't matter if the pastor does it, it doesn't matter if somebody else does it, whoever that it is, if you ever see a problem and you ever see something that needs to be addressed, you address it the Bible way no matter who it is. And don't let it sweep under the rug. You make sure that it's taken care of. And you approach the Bible way. Remember we talked about how to handle problems. You handle that the right way, no matter who that it is. God forbid you ever see me. And this has happened. I talked to Brother Houston, and we talked one time. He said how he's had to go to churches and help deal with problems. And it was a result of the pastor's bad decisions. It doesn't matter who it is. We can't be the type to where we just let sin be swept under the rug. We have a respect of we don't have a respect of persons in judgment. If somebody does wrong, we get that taken care of. And we don't let that just get pushed to the wayside. We don't let that just get covered up. We take care of it. We don't gossip about it. We don't go around and tell everybody. Listen, and here's the last thing. Don't make a YouTube video about it. Please, amen. Don't get on YouTube and say, you'll never guess who I just found, and, you know, secret camera. And then put it on the whole, for the whole world to see. That's the craziest and anti-biblical thing to do. I hate these pastors that every time they have a problem in their church, first thing they do is make a YouTube video about it. I don't care what happens at your church. I have enough problems dealing with my own life, much less with your problems at your church. Is that how God said to handle it? No. God said when there is a problem, you take it to the church, not the world. Amen. And that's where gossip comes into play. Some of these pastors are gossiping on social media because they want everybody else to know about it. And God says it doesn't, it's not everybody else's business. Don't put it on Facebook. Well, we Facebook faster than we talk to people, amen. Well, we Twitter faster, amen. Heard a pastor one time say, what is Twitter? Is that like a gay parakeet or something, amen? And I said, amen, oh, burn it. And so important. You see a problem, it doesn't matter who it is, it needs to get addressed. But make sure it addresses the right way. Don't have a respect of persons in judgment, even when it comes to inside our local church. If there's a problem that's got to be taken care of, we take care of it. And let's do it the right way. And let's not sweep under the rug just because of maybe who had done it. Because what that does is that brings a reproach to the name of Christ. Where Jesus is hurt because we would have a respect of persons. Where we would, boy, if it was this person, we'd be the first to yell about it. Ah, you never guessed. But when it's somebody else that we know or close to, that's harder. And it is hard to do. But don't have that respect of persons. Amen. So that's respect inside the house of God. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. Pray that you'd bless, Lord, the lesson that continued from last week. Thank you, Lord, for the time that we've had. Thank you, Lord, for the missionary being with us. Boy, we've sure, Lord, enjoyed, Lord, our hearts being touched. I know mine was touched, Lord, for, Lord, these dear people that need the gospel. And Lord, as we go soul winning tomorrow, Lord, may we have in our mind, Lord, a mission to reach our city, but also to reach this world. Lord, how important that it is to, Lord, get the gospel to a lost and dying world. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us that we would not have this respect of persons when it comes to the gospel, that we'd give everybody the same opportunity, the same chance to hear and trust Jesus as their Savior. We love you. Bless all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, real fast, prayer requests. Amen. Anything to pray for? Ms. Havner.
Pray for Charity's daycare provider, Kim. She had to have foot surgery.
So pray for daycare provider Kim. Kim Stevens, pray for her. Had foot surgery?
Yes.
Amen. Anybody else? Anything else to pray for? Miss Cece. So she ripped her small intestine. Pray for her daughter Katie, had a rip in small intestine and then still has the leg problems. Phew. And then several unspoken. Amen. Anybody else? Ms. Havner, I'm sorry?
Pray for Sarah's mom. I guess she had surgery yesterday.
Oh, I'm sorry. What's your mom's name? Huh?
Cherie.
Do you know how to spell that? How do you spell it? C-H-E-R-I-E. Tell her we'll be praying for her. Amen. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Pray for Miss Mercedes, has an unspoken. Anybody else? Anything else to pray for? Keep our missionaries in prayer, amen. The Robidoux family. And I've had to practice that. R-O-B-I-D-E-A-U. Right? Praise the Lord. Amen. I'll forget that next week, brother. Amen. But so keep them in prayer. Amen. And while they're here and then as they go back. Anybody else? Anything else to pray for? Yes, ma'am. I'll pray for her brother. He's home alone. And if you know Austin, that's not good. No, I'm just kidding. Amen. No, he's a good kid. Anybody else? Anything else to pray for? Yes, ma'am. That's right.
And also, salvation for Ashley and
Amen. Pray for salvation for Hunter and Ashley's mom. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Pray that God will have his way there. Amen. Anybody else? Make sure. No? Okay, sorry. Didn't want to miss anybody. Anybody else? Any prayer requests? Going once, going twice. Sold to the Becker Tire man. It's going to be, what is it now?
Best One.
Best One. Amen. So Brian at Best One is the one to hook you up. Sounds like a hotel. Best Western, Best One. Amen. Anybody else? We'll make sure. All right, good. Let's pray for these, and let's keep these in prayers. Isn't it good to see that answered prayer list get longer and longer and longer? Well, that's a blessing. Amen. Pray for safe travels. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, we'll pray for these, and then we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we love you. Thank you, Lord, for the day. Thank you, Lord, for God's people, Lord, being so faithful to the house of God. So thank you, Lord, for them. And Lord, thank you for the night that we've had, Lord, a little bit longer than normal. Thank you, Lord, so much for the blessing, and Lord, that you give to us. Thank you, Lord, for all those that have come. Lord, they've been working all day, or Lord, some haven't even eaten supper yet. And Lord, I thank you for their love for you to be here. Lord, I pray that you'd bless them, bless these prayer requests that have been made mention. Lord, and as we pray for these throughout the week, Lord God, would you please meet the needs. Lord, I would want you to answer them all tomorrow. Lord God, I would want them all to be just taken care of. But Lord, I know that sometimes your will is different. Lord God, would you help us to, Lord, continue to pray. Lord, as we get an answer from you, Lord, sometimes, Lord, quickly, sometimes not as fast, Lord, as what we would like it, but Lord, all on your timetable. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to learn to trust you, and that, Lord, you know what's best for our lives, Lord, no matter what the area and circumstance. Lord, I pray that you'd bless, Lord, this missionary family. Thank you, Lord, for them being with us. Lord, what a joy to have had them. Lord, I pray that you'd bless them as they travel. Bless their work, Lord, as they're away. And Lord, just pray that you'd bless their family. Lord, thank you so much for a family that's been, that's yielded to you, Lord, to serve you with their lives. And I pray that you'd just bless their home in a special way. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless, Lord, all that they do. Lord, thank you for our church. Lord, bless now as we go home. Bless, Lord, our week. May you keep everyone safe, watch over us, guide us and direct us. And we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Hey.